Good afternoon, and welcome to the annual Sister Marie Augusta Neal SND Lecture, sponsored by the Center for Mission and Spirituality and the Office of Development and Alumni Relations. The Sister Marie Augusta Neal SND Lecture is dedicated to promoting the social justice mission of Emmanuel College. This annual lecture honors one of Emmanuel's most esteemed graduates and faculty members, Sister Marie Augusta Neal SND, class of 1942. Who influenced several generations of students and scholars worldwide through her inspirational teaching and her numerous groundbreaking publications on social justice and change and women in the church. I now invite up Father John Spencer, SJ, College Chaplain and Director of Campus Ministry, to give a short reflection on the life of Sister Marie Augusta Neal and to lead us in our invocation this afternoon. Father John.
Thank you, Katrina. I knew Marie Augusta Neal. For many years, she was a guest lecturer at BC and Harvard, and she taught me sociology. And this was back in the early 70s. And she was quite radical in her time. In fact, she was quite a revolutionary. And I've picked out two quotes that I'd like to read to you, which kind of embody what her spirit was about. And I need to give you a little bit of background. Teaching for so long here at Emmanuel and at other universities and schools around the Boston area, she influenced a number of people. One of them was Kip Ternan. I don't know, do many of you know Kip Ternan? And Kip founded Rosie's Place. It was a shelter, began as a shelter for homeless women and gradually expanded into residential job training, a big organization. And she was influenced by Marie Augusta Neal. And Kip took Marie's theory and her viewpoint of sociology and brought it into the practical realm, how it really affects people. And Rosie's Place is a huge, huge success to this day. She also influenced Marie Augusta Neal, also influenced many clergy and other religious orders of women in the Boston area and nationally. And she was on the boards of many religious women congregations in terms of advising them during the Second Vatican Council. Now, what I'd like to read to you are two passages taken from two different studies that she ran, both of which were highly, highly controversial studies. But it gives you some idea into her viewpoint and into her approach to life. And the first one is from 1965, and she's referring to religious orders of men and women. Now remember, 1965 was just following the Second Vatican Council. It was just wrapping up. And she wrote, "Every religious community, in the spirit of the council, must adjust to the changed conditions of the times. This means that no community can continue in the traditional form and be working with the mind of the church. Any organizational structure becomes a deadening weight in time and needs to be revitalized." Now, that is an astounding statement, particularly to make in 1965. But this is the spirit of Marie Augusta Neal, and this is how she had so much influence and was such a controversial figure in Boston. In 1966, she wrote, again from another study that she conducted, "Social justice and charity are the keys for determining the adequacy of a congregation's work," meaning religious orders of men and women. "Social justice refers to a condition in society where the rules are such that by abiding by them allows the greatest possible freedom for each man and woman to develop their human potential. Many modern communities are far from that ideal. This is the ideal of the Christian community in the ideal of religious life." Again, another remarkably radical statement. So it is in this tradition that we welcome Deborah Rambo here to join us as she gives us the annual Maria Augusta Neal Lecture. Now I'll open with a prayer. Loving God, as we come into your presence with open hearts and hands, we acknowledge that we are your people and that you hear our words. Following in the spirit of Maria Augusta, we again open our minds to new ideas, to new thoughts, to new words, and we ask that through your guidance of the Spirit, we may take these words to heart and make them our own. Amen. Welcome.
Thank you, Father John. Today we are honored to have with us Mrs. Debbie Rambo, President of Catholic Charities, Archdiocese of Boston. In her current role, Mrs. Rambo is responsible for guiding the strategic direction of one of the largest social services not-for-profit agencies in Massachusetts. For more than 32 years, Mrs. Rambo has had the opportunity to serve in all of Catholic Charities' community service centers and divisions as an advocate for the poor and working poor. In her previous position as Vice President of Services, Mrs. Rambo had management oversight responsibility for all programs and services offered by the agency. Most notably under her leadership, the agency's child care division has grown into an industry leader. The English for Speakers of Other Languages programs have become consistently recognized as among the highest quality in the state. And youth programs like the Teen Center at St. Peter's have earned recognition by state and local leaders for their innovation and efficacy. During the more than 15 years after joining Catholic Charities, Mrs. Rambo has served as a clinical social worker and program director, working with at-risk children and families in disadvantaged communities. Mrs. Rambo holds a Bachelor of Arts in Sociology from Pennsylvania State University and a Master's of Social Work from Boston College. Please join me in welcoming our 2012 Sister Maria Augusta Neal Lecture guest speaker, Mrs. Debbie Rambo.
Thank you, Jordan, for that great introduction. And I might have to turn off this mic. What you're going to see scrolling are some pictures of our work. We have a wonderful photographer on our staff. And rather than show you any of the text or any of the bullet points that I might be focusing on today, I thought you might like to see pictures of our work. And if any of them provoke questions, hang on to them to answer questions when I'm finished, okay? So thank you very much for this opportunity to be with you this afternoon. Mark, thank you for inviting me today. And also, would you pass along my thanks to Sister Janet, who I know couldn't be with us today, but tell her I said thank you. And a special thank you to the wonderful, really spectacular volunteers that we get the benefit of at Catholic Charities. Your Emmanuel volunteers are really remarkable and help us in lots of ways. So we're especially appreciative of that from Catholic Charities. While I did not have the privilege of knowing Sister Maria Augusta, I sure wish I had. Her lifetime commitment to the pursuit of social justice and her ability to educate and inspire students was truly a gift to all. But before we get too far along, I just want to answer a question you all might have. Yes, my last name really is Rambo, spelled just like the movie. There's times when that's a little challenging, but generally speaking, Rambo name serves as an effective conversation starter, and usually people do remember the name. So no complaints, at least not today. Now on to the topic of the afternoon. As Sister Maria Augusta, I'm sure, would have reminded us, our Catholic faith calls us collectively and individually to work for social justice. We hear this call in the Gospel of Matthew. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. We hear this call from Pope Leo XIII. and his work to reduce the church's isolation from the world at the time of the Industrial Revolution. We hear this call from Thomas Aquinas, who taught that church and world are distinct, but called to collaborate for the good of the human community. We hear this call from Pope John XXIII and Vatican II, and their teaching regarding social justice, charity, common good, and subsidiarity. We hear this call from Blessed Mother Teresa, who referred to Matthew 25 as the one-handed gospel. You did this to me. We hear this call from Pope Benedict most recently, who writes in his encyclical letter, Deus Caritas Est, within the community of believers, there can never be room for a poverty that denies anyone what is needed for a dignified life. We hear this call from Cardinal Theodore McCarrick, who says simply, caring for the poor is God's work and God's favorite work. Many of you might not be aware that the American Catholic Church has developed an extensive fabric of social institutions, charities, healthcare institutions, schools, certainly here, rooted in the ministries of the church, but serving American society as a whole. These institutions serve as a bridge between the church and the wider society. Theologian Father Brian Hare describes our work this way. As a ministry and as an institution, our social institutions are an expression of the Catholic commitment to justice and charity and represents the Catholic community in American society. At Catholic Charities, we say, we do what we do because not because you are Catholic, but because we are Catholic. We do what we do, not because you are Catholic, but because we are Catholic. In fact, Catholic Charities agencies across the country together serve approximately 25% of the nation's poor. And it seems that today our services are more needed than ever, especially because we are seeing today in the social service sector is a social policy that expects less from the state and other public agencies, more from the market, and a great deal from nonprofit organizations. We see this social policy in action in today's news, and certainly in the coverage of our presidential election and presidential politics, which have been dotted with references to the poor. Earlier this year, Mitt Romney attracted a lot of attention when he commented that he was not worried about the very poor because they had a social safety net. A comment that highlights one of our modern day truths. We, as a society, really do not spend much time thinking about the very poor. And yet poverty is a problem with very real economic, political, and moral implications and consequences. Recent U.S. Census Bureau data tells us that 46 million Americans are living in poverty today, more than ever before. As startling is the report of the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, the Association of the World's Developed Countries, which ranks the U.S. 31st out of the 34 countries in terms of the percentage of our population that qualifies as poor. Only Mexico, Chile, and Israel are worse off than we are. In addition, the 2012 Assets and Opportunity Scorecard, released earlier this year by the Corporation for Economic Development, indicated that there is a diminishing financial security in the United States, with over a quarter of households, roughly 27%, qualifying as asset poor. This means that these households lack the savings or assets to cover their living expenses if they lose income due to a layoff or other emergency. This is a 21% increase over those in asset poverty captured in the 2009-2010 scorecard. So again, a big difference year over year. Let's take a look locally. We looked at the world, we looked at us compared to other countries, we looked at across the country, but let's look locally. The Boston Foundation's 2011 report, Measures of Poverty, notes that throughout 2005 to 2009, an estimated 90,000 Bostonians, not including college students, were living in poverty. That's a big number. The study also noted that wealth has become more concentrated in Boston. In 2009, the top 5% of earners accounted for more than 25% of the total annual income in the city. But the bottom 20% earned just 2.2% of the total. Indeed, poverty has deepened in Boston's poorest neighborhoods, widening the gap between the city's wealthiest and neediest residents. The Boston Foundation study points to concentrated need in Dorchester, Mattapan, and Roxbury, where 42% of the children live in poverty, the densest cluster of childhood poverty in the state, and where poverty is fueled by unemployment and low educational attainment. In these three communities, 85% of families are headed by a single parent, mainly mothers, and at least 20% of the adults have no high school diploma. Race is also a factor. For example, in 1990, 24% of African American children across the city lived in poverty. Nearly two decades later, that figure has risen to 35%. Similar increases can be found in Boston's Latino community and to some extent in the Asian community. The study also found that from 1990 to 2009, the cost of living in Boston increased by 68%, while federal poverty guidelines that set a benchmark for government aid rose by only 55%. The Crittenton Women's Union has created an economic index that explains that for 2010, an average family in Massachusetts, a single parent family with one preschooler and one school-age child, needs an income of $61,618 to meet its day-to-day essential expenses without public assistance. The federal poverty guidelines issued to determine eligibility for certain federal programs is $19,090 for the same family, a big gap. Sadly, children are among the hidden victims of our economic recession, and childhood hunger is on the rise. The Greater Boston Food Bank reports that the food insecurity rate for children living in Massachusetts is 18%, significantly higher than the general population. The number of children facing hunger is as high as 1 in 4 in many of the communities we serve. We run a food pantry in that neighborhood, that strip of Dorchester, Mattapan, and Roxbury. 5 years ago, 2008, we distributed approximately 5,000 pounds of food a month. Today, we're distributing 15,000 pounds of food a week. It's just a huge, huge effort to meet the need of the community. We know, too, that children enrolled in our early education and care programs often are fed the only nutritious meals they will have during that day while in our care. And we know that the lack of food has a devastating impact on children, physically, emotionally, and academically. Research tells us that children who struggle with hunger are sick more often, recover more slowly, and are more likely to be hospitalized. They are more likely to experience headaches, stomach aches, colds, ear infections, and fatigue. The lifelong health impacts of hunger are clear. Children who face hunger are more susceptible to obesity and its harmful health consequences, both as children and as adults. In addition, children who regularly do not get enough nutritious food to eat have significantly higher levels of behavioral, emotional, and academic problems, and are more anxious and aggressive, while teens that regularly do not get enough to eat are found more likely to be suspended from school and generally have difficulty getting along with other kids. And so because we see our neighbors suffering, especially in this challenging economy, our faith calls us to action. And the church in Boston is responding in a number of ways. For example, within the Boston Archdiocese, we have Catholic Charities, the Planning Office for Urban Affairs, and St. Mary's Women and Children's Center. Three institutions actually still working in that Dorchester, Roxbury, Mattapan strip. The Planning Office serves as a catalyst for social justice through its work in housing development neighborhood revitalization, and affordable housing advocacy. St. Mary's Women and Children's Center in Dorchester provides homeless and low-income women and children in the city of Boston with the resources and skills necessary to build stable, healthy lives in the community. And at Catholic Charities, for more than 100 years, we have continued our mission of building a just and compassionate society rooted in the dignity of all people. As Jordan mentioned, we're one of the largest providers of social services in Massachusetts. Catholic Charities of Boston provides nearly 100 programs and services in its 33 locations throughout eastern Massachusetts, so our footprint is the same as the diocese. And again, as Jordan mentioned, we are second only to the state in terms of the amount of services that we provide. Our goals at Catholic Charities are to help people become self-sufficient, to meet the needs of the poor and the working poor in our communities, to strengthen and preserve families, to provide children with the opportunities that they deserve. And we welcome newcomers, assisting as they adjust to their new surroundings and become active participants in their communities. Last year, Catholic Charities served more than 200,000 individuals across eastern Massachusetts through the efforts of 600 full and part-time staff and 2,500 volunteers. More than 60% of our clients are non-Catholic. Again, we do what we do not because our clients are Catholic, but because we are Catholic. So, we've talked a little bit about the call to social justice, described some of the need we're seeing in our communities, and shared a bit about the work of Catholic Charities. Finally, I wanted to share some of my thoughts about leadership. As you've heard, I've spent my entire professional life in the field of social justice at Catholic Charities. Why do I do this work? In part, I draw a line directly back to a Catholic upbringing. I was raised in a large Irish Catholic family. Rambo is my married name. solidly middle class. But the message from my parents, whether spoken or unspoken, was that it was important to give back, and importantly, that actions spoke louder than words. I certainly was influenced by the leaders of my childhood, John Kennedy, Martin Luther King, Robert Kennedy, and their calls to service, racial equality, and social justice. It was a growing up shaped by Lyndon Johnson's war on poverty, the Vietnam War, and the protests of the anti-war movement. I was a freshman in college when the Vietnam War ended. But the person who helped me really focus in on sociology and social work as a field of study and possible career was one teacher, Steve. He was a college student from Villanova, who was my high school CCD, religious formation teacher. My parents sent us to parochial school for a few years. We moved around a lot and then ended up in public schools, but my parents insisted that we go to CCD until we graduated from high school. It was lucky for me because I met Steve. He taught about how important it was to use your talents to make a difference in the world in the pursuit of social justice. So off I went to college and then to graduate school where I earned my MSW, and then I came to Catholic Charities, planning to stay for 2 years because, frankly, the salary was awful. It was low, like $10,000 a year. But at the time, 2 years was the expected minimum commitment required by the profession. The social work profession really wanted you to be there, hang in there. There was no job hopping to be had. I began working with families, young parents, and families where children were believed to be at risk of abuse and neglect. I soon learned that Catholic Charities was a place where I could make a difference and where I could learn. Two things that made it possible for me to stay and build a career. So my time at Catholic Charities has had two phases, the first half in direct service, the second in management and leadership. And so I want to leave you with a few thoughts about strategies to consider that I believe can help contribute for all of us to the greater good. At the risk of sounding like your mother, be nice. Please be nice. It really makes a difference, and I can't really stress how important this is. Understand power. It will help you when you try to solve problems all the time. understand the issues, never stop learning, because knowledge is power. Find a friend, a mentor, develop alliances, because no problem can be solved alone. Do not ignore politics. They may be ugly, but government is an important partner as we attempt to solve some of the most intractable problems we face today. It's all about compromise. There is no one right way to solve a problem. And lastly, I would suggest a sense of humor is very important. It will really help you get through the hard times. Remember, she who laughs lasts. Thank you. So now I am delighted to answer any questions you have about our work, about our purpose, about slides that you might have seen. We do a whole lot of service. Sure.
It's wonderful to hear about all the good that you're doing, and we appreciate that. What are you doing? I noticed that you said that you're strengthening families. Mm-hmm. What are you doing so that the children are brought up in a total family, not just by mothers? The poor mothers are overburdened, but the greater family, mm-hmm. alone, is it possible? It's just so.
I think what's true of social services in general is that we have tended to ignore fathers. They get a little bit demonized as guys who help make babies and then disappear. So we do a couple of different things, and I wish we did a little bit more of it, but the funding is hard to come by. We have a really wonderful program called Father Support Program, and we teach the 10 principles of good fatherhood to dads mostly who don't have custody of their children, but who want to develop relationships with their children. And we try and teach that it's important to be respectful of mothers, whether you live with them or not, and that it's important to be part of your child's life, and teach some ways that that can be possible. So that's one way that we do it. We also have a couple of programs we call Healthy Families. That's part of a national model. That we work with young moms, first-time mothers, who's under the age of 21, and we welcome fathers wherever we can find them. So, you know, we understand that they're important. Sure.
You mentioned that you do work in your three communities as well. Are they the same kind of programs? What kind of programs do we have?
We are sort of a soup to nuts agency, so in the 33 programs, let me see if what's the best way to put this. We have 6 major service centers, primarily in what we're now calling gateway cities. So they're old manufacturing cities whose businesses have all left them, and where families do struggle. So Lynn, Lowell, Lawrence, Haverhill, Brockton. And then we do a lot of work in the city of Boston. In those cities, you will find we almost always have a basic needs program, whether it's a food pantry or some way to access food, rent, heat, utility assistance. We do education and training programs just about everywhere, whether it's helping new immigrants and refugees learn English and job skills, or we have lots of programs for young moms who might have left school without finishing their education, because we know how important that is. So we do those kinds of services. People are usually surprised to hear we have 1,100 kids in childcare on any given day, most of that north of the city and in the city, a National Association for the Education of Young Children accredited, NAEYC accredited programs. That usually surprises people to hear that. The Young Parents and Young Dads programs we talk about. And then we also have 5 shelters, transitional programs for families, primarily 3 in the city of Boston, 1 in Cambridge, 1 in Lowell. We do more, but and if it comes to me, I'll pipe up. Yep.
How can the annual students get involved in the charities?
Well, Well, I think Emmanuel students right now volunteer, I believe, at St. Ambrose, right? Which is a family shelter. I think we have somewhere between 13 and 15 families live there. And they come and I think they're helping tutor kids and do activities with kids. It's a great, Rick Freitas is the man who runs that program. He's fantastic. So certainly helping in that way. We have a teen center at St. Peter's. I didn't mention that. So the Bowdoin-Geneva neighborhood of Dorchester is one of the city's hot spots. It's one of the most violent neighborhoods in the city. And we run a teen center there for, during the school year, about 300 middle school and high school students. During the summer, it blows up to about 500 because we do lots of recreational activities. They're always looking for tutors. So that's a great place to help. Our child care centers probably could benefit from some support. We have a Jumpstart program that works in our Nazareth Center, which is in Jamaica Plain, so reading tutorials and some of the, you know, there's so much talk about STEM education these days, and I know we focus a lot on early literacy, but I think we're going to have to come around to early math and science literacy too. So, you know, those kinds of things. But you're great volunteers already, so.
Charities have any connection with persons recently released from prison?
We have one very small program in Brockton. And Brockton has one of the highest rates of prisoners being released into the community. So actually the organization there that does really great work is the Brockton Interfaith Community, and they do really wonderful advocacy on behalf of people who are being released, but we do not a lot. I've got to say the women religious do wonderful work in aftercare, prison aftercare ministry, very quietly across this diocese, but we've not had the resources to do it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mrs. Rambo, does Catholic Charities have any services that would be supportive to undocumented persons or people that really need some support around immigration issues?
We do have a Refugee and Immigration Services. Ooh, me and the mic. And we do have a legal clinic that that does see people it's one of the few clinics that charges a very little bit of money. It's about $50 for a consultation for someone who has a complicated immigration issue. That's not always enough. I've learned, you know, I never knew very much about immigration issues, and I went to my first training about it about 15 years ago, and my takeaway was always refer to someone who knows what they're doing because it's very complicated law. And oftentimes, people who have come have overstayed a visa or come in a way that's, or the documentation's not quite right. And it's very hard to fix those problems legally without asking someone to return to their country. So we've done a lot of advocacy around the DREAM Act because we would like to see young students who are here be able to stay. You know, not always was it their responsibility that they got here. We'd like to be able to see them stay. So we do a lot of advocacy work about that. But yes, we do have one small clinic that does for a reduced, very reduced price take on some cases, but mostly is doing consultation right now.
Mm-hmm. Do you partner with any like schools in general, or is it just for the Jumpstart program and tutoring after? Is there any way?
We have, we're really fortunate, not unlike Emmanuel. We partner with the Boston College School of Social Work. They do intern placements with us. We have some, I think, students from Wheelock as well. I could get you a better list, but yes, we welcome. We have 2,500 volunteers, and they come from all different places. Bridgewater State College, Massasoit Community College, Stonehill are all folks that help us in the Brockton area. North Shore Community College in Lynn. UMass Lowell was a great help to us at Thanksgiving time. We do about... I think we did like 10,000 families with turkeys and everything that goes with it for Thanksgiving this year from a number of locations. We can't do that with the small staff that we have, so it's pretty much an all-volunteer effort.
Could you give us a little idea of who your funding comes from?
About 50% of our funding is government contracts, so cities, cities and towns with their local CDGB money, their block grant money. We do have contracts with the Department of Early Education and Care for our child care, our DCF supports some of our parent aid programs. It's another program that we do work with families where we're really helping. It's a very inexpensive model where we help families where parents really are not skilled at parenting, have real hands-on experience. We have, you know, someone lives with them, it seems sometimes, but they spend probably 6 or 8 hours a week with the family trying to help them manage some basic skills, skill learning. So DCF, EEC, the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education helps fund some of our adult education programs. DTA, Department of Transitional Assistance, helps fund some of our learning programs and some of our shelter programs are funded by DCHD. It's all that, you know, that alphabet soup that's the state. We have very little federal money at this point in time just because it's not been available. Kind of surprised. Well, what's happened with federal dollars is it's been all caught up in these budget negotiations. And so even if dollars might be allocated federally, they're not releasing them. So they're doing, as they do these budget rollovers, a month at a time, 2 months at a time, it's gotten very tricky. Then the other 50% of our money comes from grants and foundation work, so gifts that we earn through them. United Way is a big supporter. We're the largest recipient of United Way dollars in Mass Bay. And then fundraising. We fundraise about $8 million a year to support programs.
Mm-hmm. So one of the things that really affects our students when they do service work is there's so much need, there's so much done, and they get sometimes very frustrated because they just want to work 24/7 while they can, because they're like, they see the need, mm-hmm. and they're like, wow, we're just making a little bit of a dent. What would you say to students, and how do you experience that in your job of seeing the need, you know, the food pantry numbers? Mm-hmm. You know, what motivates you and gets you through that understanding of the need is so great, how do we ever get close to the need?
Certainly in this recession, I guess we'll call it, with this time of economic challenges, I call it sometimes too, the demand that we see is really, it's overwhelming, not just for your students. And what we're starting to think about is, you know, what we thought was an emergency need is now an ongoing need. And so we're really starting to think together creatively about what kinds of programs do we need to put in place to be able to help people more over the long term. So we're really looking to retool some of what we do. For example, the basic needs programs, we're really able to meet almost 100% of the food requests that we get. There are limits on what people can do, how often they can ask, but by and large, if someone comes and they need food, they can get it from us. Not true of rent, heat, utility assistance. And so we just have to think better and smarter about how we help people learn how to budget. But if you're making $19,000 a year, it's hard to learn how to, you know, there's not much to budget. But even how to, you know, teach people how to be their own negotiators with utility companies. There's tricks to this. you know, the shutoff. The moratoriums have shutoff starts and ends, and there's ways to keep your utilities on, pay your bills, maybe not in their entirety, but there are ways that utility companies will work with you, and I think we have to be better teachers of some of those skills. Whoa. So we're working on that. But yeah, it's, you know, just running through the statistics, it's like, whoa. It's not only is it heartbreaking, it's like, what do you do first some days?
Mm-hmm. What is your core staff like? Who are, when you say we, who are the people that are Catholic Charities?
Traditionally, Catholic Charities was a social work agency. MSWs primarily were the made up most of the staff. That's changed a little bit because we're doing so much education. So I would say we now have more teachers than we have social workers. At Catholic Charities, certainly we have more early childhood educators. We have teachers in all of our adult education programs. The job training programs require teachers. And we do another one. We do a certified nursing assistant training program, home health aide training program, so people can get in at the ground level of the health services work. Every program has a case manager / social worker because we don't think it's not just book learning. You really need some help managing your way through these systems that we've created. So.
You talk about power when you mention leadership. And I'm interested in hearing you say more about gender and power and leadership. And for instance, what barriers did you encounter as a woman leader in an organization, also in politics, as male dominated?
Well, I can tell you that Catholic Charities for a long, long time was pretty lopsided. It was led by men and staffed by women. So it was probably an 80-20 split. I took my position as vice president for programs about 15 years ago, and when that happened, I was the first woman on the senior leadership team. And once they decided it was okay, now that's being a little flip. But once it seemed okay, I was quickly followed by others. And in fact, the first woman president of Catholic Charities was Tiziana Deering. But that was in 2007, in a 100-year history. So change is kind of slow to come. That said, I never really felt disrespected or that my opinion didn't matter or that I wasn't asked to be responsible in a way that anyone else was. And I really felt that my opinion mattered. The other thing, too, about Catholic Charities, it was priest-led for years and years and years. The first lay person to lead Catholic Charities was Joe Doolin. He was there for about 15 years before Father Hare came back to Boston around the time that Cardinal Law left Boston. So it's interesting to be part of a church where I think women have been, I know I have a priest here, where women have been really responsible for doing a lot of the good work and not getting good credit for it. So, I mean, let me just say that about our fine Catholic Church. Let's think about Massachusetts politics. The most powerful woman right now is Therese Murray, and she's pretty powerful. Not much happens that she doesn't have something to say about. And I think Governor Patrick is an interesting guy who's a team builder. He's appointed a lot of good women to positions in his administration. So I think it depends on, I don't think we're all there yet. There's certainly still a glass ceiling.
Catholic Church?
No, we have Muslim staff. We have staff of all stripes. In my position, you're required to be Catholic, but everywhere, the vice president for programs now is a good Baptist. He's a great guy. He says he studies a lot about Catholics.
When you mentioned about Massachusetts politics, I know with changes in our society and laws that no longer are involved in the adoption of children. Now, with the question of the mandate that's coming up, Health and Human Services, what effect will that have if it is made a law?
I think that's a big worry nationally. We have August of 2013 until we get to a point where we have to make some decisions and there's room to mediate. I can just tell you, in my personal opinion, this does not represent the agency's opinion, that President Obama was pretty clumsy when he rolled this policy out, that there was a way that he could have done this to save the institutional church some agita. You know, I'm not sure that he didn't care as much. It was pretty clear he didn't understand what he was asking church officials to do. And he didn't understand that most of the dioceses were self-insured. So if you're self-insured and your insurer has to provide the coverage, you're asking yourself to do it. So, you know, he just didn't understand the level of complexity. And I must say, when back to your question about power, one of the things that was most startling to me when I moved from doing clinical work to moving to do administrative work at Catholic Charities was the move from playing chess to three-dimensional chess to four-dimensional chess. There are so many complexities in doing work as a church-based agency, and I think the Obama administration just didn't understand it.
Even after
conversations
with
Dr. Bill?
Even after. Okay, yeah. It has such a difference in the conversation.
Yeah.
Please join me again in thanking Mrs. Debbie Rambo for speaking at the annual Sister Maria event.